my name's Sarah Banks. I'm in neurosciences, and I'm very privileged to be here today. So thank you to the organizers for inviting me, and to Dr. Lacroix for setting up my talk so nicely. So I have 3 minutes to convince you a little bit about Alzheimer's disease in women, and specifically why sex differences matter, and tell you a bit about what we're doing to learn about that here at UCSD. So firstly, Alzheimer's disease differs in very key ways between women and men. So one of those ways that I've become particularly fascinated with is in the pathology. So the two hallmark pathologies of Alzheimer's disease are amyloid and tau pathology. And tau specifically shows very distinct patterns in women compared with men, specifically during the mild cognitive impairment phase, so that area between normal cognition and dementia. Women, for some reason, have what I call it an inferno of tau. So compared with men who have a kind of a linear addition of tau over time, women have this kind of blossoming of tau. And we don't know why that is. And having learning the key to that might help us with better treatments and diagnoses down the line. Secondly, Alzheimer's disease is missed frequently in women. And that's partly because we're just better naturally at verbal memory tasks, and that also happens to be how we test for Alzheimer's disease. So that's a big problem. But despite this, two-thirds, as we heard earlier, of Alzheimer's cases are women. So perhaps we can crack the code in Alzheimer's first, and that'll help everyone who might get this. The second big issue is that treatments haven't really worked yet. So the graphic there that you see on the left is all of the trials that were underway in 2022. Each of those trials costs millions to billions of dollars and takes about a decade. And so far, there's been a more than 99% failure rate, so that's a big problem. And even medications that do get through, such as the new medication Leqembi, when we break it down by women and men, the women in the study did not show a benefit. Despite that, it was FDA approved. Personally, as someone who works in Alzheimer's and as a woman, I see that as a bit of a problem. There is new hope and breakthroughs of understanding of modifiable risk, which is a lot of the work that we do here. And we think that sex stratification might help us find effective treatments. Thirdly, there are differences in risk factors in Alzheimer's disease. APOE4 is the strongest genetic risk factor, and it's a much stronger risk factor in women than it is in men. Modifiable risk factors like exercise and sleep just hit differently in women than men, which is something that we're looking into, and we miss a lot of that modifiable risk due to gender bias in medicine. So what are we doing about that here at UCSD? Well, we have two big NIA-funded, for now, projects, the Women Inflammation and Tau study, which has been going on for a few years. And I just want to mention a few of the highlights that we're finding with our early results there. One is that sleep apnea is incredibly common in these women. They all get a home sleep test. More than 70% of the women in the study, only one or two of them came into the study knowing they had sleep apnea. More than 70% of them have it, and half of those have moderate to severe apnea. So massive thing that's being missed. Going back to that gender difference and gender bias in medicine, women tend not to snore loudly when they have sleep apnea, and that's the way that it's kind of screened by primary care. Do you snore? Do you snore loudly? Generally, women do not, even though many, many of them have this. Other things like diabetes and prediabetes, we've heard a bit about them, and we're looking at how that actually interacts with sedentary lifestyle to predict tau pathology. And lastly, I just want to mention our Black Women Inflammation and Tau study. Black women are at the highest risk of any demographic group to get Alzheimer's disease. So we have a study that's really specific to Black and African American women, leveraging what we can do now with blood biomarkers. So I'm happy to chat with anyone more about that and brag about our research all day, because I think it's very important. But for now, I just have those 3 minutes, and I'm in my fourth. So thank you very much.